We're in this really nice cool down effect right now. Dusk is settling upon the parched land here, although it's not so parched. It's actually been a cool summer in the Bay Area, but I know the rest of the country, USA, is suffering horribly from the parched land. We're spoiled here, but you know, it's good to know that somewhere the sun is shining, as it were. It's very important that we accept the principle of some being saved, at some experiencing good fortune, at some really breathing the air of freedom, to keep that alive in us when our land is parched and we think, oh my gosh, you know, everything is terrible, to come across someone, something, situation where everything is wonderful is so helpful. Some will get sour grapes. You know, there's a division there, right? Some will hate them, just hate it. Say, how come I'm suffering when they're experiencing such good fortune? I hate God. I hate it. You know, blah, I hate everything. There must be suffering. They're terrible. You know, sour grapes, right? Sour grapes. Some will do the sour grapes. Others will say, oh, thank God that some have responded to the principle of grace and are showing us that there is this principle of grace and it is possible to respond to it. Thank God, because then they know whatever terrible thing I'm experiencing now, I know it's not going to last forever. It's not going to last forever. It's not forever. It's not forever. And existence is not forever. It thinks it's forever. It believes it's forever. It believes it's more than forever, but it's not. So, you know, you got to go one way or the other with this one. There's trying to play it in the middle is just going to tear you apart. If you see someone who really has genuine, you know, like they've escaped the trap, as it were, and you're going to decide which way to go, and you just have to go one way or the other. There's no getting around that. And you can say, oh, you know, thank God somebody has escaped, because I know that guarantees my escape too, guarantees it. That's a wonderful thing. So we know that the rest of the country is just getting hammered. And I'm sitting here in a most beautiful place and most calm, and it's green and everything's growing beautifully, and we've had, you know, cool summer and no problems, and occasionally we get a warm day and it's wonderful, but everything is just wonderful. And that certainly helps not getting into severely, you know, negative mood, right? It helps me stay buoyant and keep pushing and keep working hard and keep being determined, you know, to be of some sort of help and service, however anyone takes it to be. So ideally we would want to see somebody that's in just a great situation, really, and is sharing that with us. The problem is, what I see is that those who are like super rich, they don't share it. They don't share their situation. I don't expect them to share their money with us. I expect them to share their situation with us, and they don't do it. It's amazing. I have searched on the internet everywhere. I cannot come across one situation where someone who is truly blessed with affluence and beautiful place, etc., 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 is using their time to share that with people and saying, look, this is the blessing that I've gotten, and this is the blessing that's possible, and this is how I got it. You know, they're not doing it. It's unbelievable. I do searches for all these like fabulous country clubs and people who are so privileged to live there, and not a single one of them has like set up a webcam, has set up a site where they're showing people, hey, look at this beautiful place I'm at. Look at this, you know, beautiful home, beautiful area, beautiful people, beautiful lifestyle, beautiful everything. It's so wonderful. I'm so blessed. And showing it to us so we can say, you know, this is possible. this is possible. And then sharing, you know, their attitude. It used to be people who were blessed would share it. You know, they'd say, look, I live this powerful lifestyle of faith, and I applied the principles that I've been taught through the high teachings of some high religious teaching, spiritual teaching, and I've been blessed by it, and they would, you know, share that. You don't see that now. You see these people in these enclaves, and it's like shut down. You don't hear a word from them. It's the weirdest thing. Just try it. Just try, you know, try finding somebody. I know the places. I know the places. So I can search for them, and there's nobody there saying a word. It's like they're invisible. They don't want anybody to know they even exist because they don't want to risk the ire of sour grapes, you know. And, you know, if I was in their shoes, maybe I'd feel different. Maybe I'd feel that way too. I don't know. But it seems to me that they need, you know, they need to get a little more courage of their convictions and share with the world their situation. And of course, they're afraid that people will come knocking on their door saying, give me your wealth, give me your wealth. You know, no, they don't have any obligation to give, just hand over their wealth to anybody, because they have worked hard for it in a lot of cases. Not all, you know. Of course, there are exceptions to that, but many have worked very hard. They've been fortunate, you know. Some have been ruthless, that is true. But if, whatever the situation, everybody has to do their best. And if sharing beautiful places with people can inspire others, it should be done. It should be done. It's not being done. I pray that I get in one of those places and share it with the world. You know, share it. See, look how gorgeous this place is. I know some places that are off the chart beautiful and gorgeous, and people live there are so, so fortunate. And they need to share it, because the people in this world all over the place who are just absolutely hating, you know, I mean, the situations. You know, when you are surrounded with a terrible drought, it is awful. It is awful. California has gone through droughts, not like the, you know, the rest of the country is going through, but there have been times we had to let our whole yard die. We had to let everything die, not just the lawn, but the plants. Had to stop watering everything. Everything died. And it took us like 20 years to recover. It took us a long, long time to recover. And it's traumatized. You know, every time we use water, we're thinking, oh my gosh, we're wasting water. Oh my gosh, we're wasting water. We can't waste water. And we get a guilt complex, and you think, you know, you feel this terrible crush of scarcity on you. It's just horrible, horrible. And so the people who are going through the drought now, and seeing the crops die, seeing the food die, seeing their livelihoods, you know, being crushed, feeling the parchedness of the land, feeling how fragile the whole thing is. It's such a trauma. It is such a terrible, deep, deep trauma. And I believe it helps for them to say, you know what? It's like you're in this terrible fog that descends and lasts for like 6 months of this dense, cold, clammy fog, and you start going crazy and you think, you know, this is all that there is. And then you look on a screen and somebody's there in the beautiful, clear, sparkling sunlight, and they're just so refreshed, and you see them and you say, oh my gosh, there's some place where somewhere the sun is shining. Somewhere it's shining. And you say to this fog, you know what, fog, I'm going to escape you. I'm going to escape you. I'm going to find the sun, as it were. I feel that's it's very important. Very important. Misery loves company, but not that much. It loves seeing how to escape misery even more. Right? Even more. So let us not succumb to this misery loves company, what we think we want, type of thing and shift over to what we really want is how to escape the misery. Before we can escape it, we have to believe it's possible. We have to see, you know, examples like, oh, okay. Like if I see a great guru, a great teacher, I'm so happy for them that they're free, you know, and it's like, wow, thank you for being, showing me this and for being so free and so happy. You know, I'm happy for you. Anybody that is good fortune, I'm happy for them, very happy for them, because that shows that, you know, it's possible for me too. If we don't have any examples, where can we go but into despair? Really? Really? So, I just pray that, you know, I get put into a super nice situation and I'll record from there and I'll share. I'll say, look, you know, look at this. Look at this place. If I could go to heaven and bring back video, I'd do so. You know, I don't think it can be caught digitally. So, but I'd say, look how beautiful this is. You know, look how, you know, happy. Look how we feel here. Look at the surroundings. Look at it. Just the weather's perfect. It's ideal. We feel buoyant, you know, and it's just great. And share that with the world. It's not so difficult. Not so difficult. I try to do that. I mean, right here now, it's like perfect. Hear all the crickets everywhere, you know. It's so quiet. And it's very civilized. It's not some, you know, we're not out in the boondocks, you know, and worried about, you know, what's rustling in the bush or something. No, it's very sedate, very civilized, and yet very calm, very quiet. The atmosphere is very peaceful. The air is very good. Could be better. And it's just a perfect evening. No complaints. So again, I am astounded. Well, I'm really astounded by the lack of initiative and courage of the world at this time. It's astounding. People are so afraid to stick their heads up, afraid they're going to get hammered down. You know, so afraid, so intimidated. And everybody is like circling the family wagons and going into enclaves and family tribal groups and shutting themselves into a bubble like that. And, you know, if they, you know, get the money, if they get the prosperity, if they get it, you know, they're building this bubble around themselves. And, you know, if you're part of that situation, you're in. If you're not, you know, forget it. You are completely out. If someone's really happy, they should share it with the world. They should show it. If someone's in a really great place, they should show it. They should share it. You know, if somebody lives on a point in Hawaii somewhere where the house is overlooking, you know, the bay and the water and the sunset, and they have this mansion there, they should broadcast from there. They should show it. They should show, hey, you know, and bring that vibe to the world. Help out. Help bring this a vibe of peace, of calm, of harmony, of beauty, of freedom from law, you know, whatever you can to elevate the vibe. So people start feeling, being able to reach up to freedom, to what they really want. That's all. My teachers, you know, came in the world, Jesus Christ first, Ramana Maharshi, and then Anandamayi Ma, they came in the world. They showed us, you know, what the vibe of reality. They showed us what we really want, and we felt that, and we say, oh my gosh, I want to start reaching up towards that. I want to start reaching for it. And they said, yeah, please do. You're very welcome, for sure. And so it's a very positive thing, very positive. You know, I saw Anandamayi Ma videos and pictures of her, and I said, oh my gosh, whatever she has, you know, I want that too. Whatever paradise she's dwelling in, I want to dwell there too. So show me the way. Thank you for coming down and showing us, you know, that this is possible. That's it. You know? No sour grapes. Those who have sour grapes feel that they're hopeless. They have no hope. So they're being tantalized. You know, they're being teased. It's not true. It's not true. There is a way. There is a way. The Passover principle is the way. Automatically, when you realize that reality needs no defense, you then are put. You are. Def, you are in an attitude that the whole hypothetical scenario of loss automatically has to pass you by and doesn't leave you nowhere, leaves you in the realm, the paradise realm, the loss-free realm, which needs no defense. Truth needs no defense. Reality needs no defense. Our defense, trying to defend it, is just feeding into the delusion that it's vulnerable. So, existence is a loss-based scenario. Trying to annihilate itself. So it's only looking for what can be annihilated, what can be harmed, what can be suffer loss, what can suffer loss. That's all that it all that it can see. And if you accept the fact that reality can't, it never suffer loss, then loss cannot see you. This whole devouring cannot see you. Doesn't recognize you as anything that it wants at all. And it passes you by. That's the Passover principle. Saved by the blood of Christ. The blood means the spirit. Okay. Ancients thought the spirit was in the blood, that blood was the spirit. Literally, they thought that the blood literally was the spirit. It was very literalism, you know. So the blood of Christ means the spirit of Christ, which is what? Defenselessness. Defenselessness. He put up no defense. He put up no defense. He knew that reality doesn't need to be defended. And he said, if it wasn't given for you in this witnessing I'm doing to harm the body, you couldn't even harm a hair on the head of this body, you know. And even though you're going to kill this body, it will be raised up again. Knowing all of that, there's a defenselessness. Perfect fear, a perfect love cast out all fear. And love your enemy, turn the other cheek, agree with your adversary. All those things. Blessed are the poor in spirit. Blessed are those who are defenseless, as it were. But defenseless in the right, in the proper, wise, clear way of meaning. That they don't feel they need to defend reality. That is not reality doesn't need defense. Therefore, I, you, everyone, doesn't need to be in a trying to figure out how to defend reality. Reality's not vulnerable. So we can give up that attempt to defend reality. And when we do that, the whole scenario of loss has to pass us by. Like we're nothing. It doesn't see anything it wants. It only wants loss. And it sees loss by defensiveness. In other words, somebody is seeing as valuable something that can suffer loss. And existence sniffs that out and says, ah, I need to attack this one because that's where I can get some more loss. But if you realize you're not defending anything because nothing real is threatened, nothing real can suffer any loss. And it doesn't sniff you out. It says, there's nothing there. There must be nothing there. Nothing there can suffer loss. Therefore, I have no interest in it. Zero. I pass it by. That's the Passover principle. And so you're freed that way. You're freed that way. You can be freed that way. It's automatic. It's automatic. And you will find yourself in an entire domain that has no defense to it. In paradise, nothing there can be lost, and there's no threat to it whatsoever. No threat. It's passed over, totally passed over. And you'll think, huh? How did I do that? You know, what kind of defense was needed? No defense. It's no defense that is what is needed. It's defenselessness or the realization that what is real needs no defense. Never has and never will. That enables some kind of release, inner release of letting go of the belief that, that you, your purpose, you need to figure out a way to defend reality against loss. Because that's ultimately, that's inside, where we think that's our obligation, our duty, and that God depends on us for that. That somehow God depends on us, the Prime Creator depends on us, all of reality depends on us to figure out a way to protect it from annihilation. Not true. No. And we feel if we give this up that somehow we will be annihilated because we gave up our purpose, our principle, our promise to God, and we, God will say, ah, this one apparently doesn't think it's needed, that reality doesn't need to be defended, so we're going to annihilate this one because they have given up their purpose. They've given up their obligation, as it were. Not true. It's the opposite of that. The Prime Creator is ceaselessly calling out to us, to say, saying, hey, reality doesn't need to be defended. Reality doesn't need any defense whatsoever. So give up, you know, you're trying to defend it because it's not necessary. Ceaselessly, reality is calling out to us that way, saying needs no defense. Reality needs no defense. None, 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 none. And so there can be this inner acceptance of this, and that inner acceptance of it, it means you're, quote unquote, you're covered by the blood of Christ, being covered by the spirit of no defensiveness, that realization, that spirit, that attitude, that real, that acceptance is now within you. You have that, and the entire dynamic of loss must pass you by, automatically passes you by without you doing anything, anything at all. And when you have it to the full extent, you will all really find yourself in paradise, in the loss-free realm, the realm where there's no loss taking place whatsoever. So there is a way. So those who have sour grapes, it's a mistake. It's a uninformed reaction based on a false premise. Somehow they have to defend reality, and you're not doing it. You're living the life of Riley, and the defense of reality is up to them, and therefore you're making it more difficult for them. It's easy to fall into that. I've been in that situation, feeling like I'm somehow I had to defend everybody because everybody was so here. They're so, sometimes they just want a party. They just, you know, and I said, my gosh, you guys are leaving yourself wide open to all sorts of dangers. I got to defend you. In existence, it's that way because existence is loss-based. So everything is threatened. Everything is threatened in existence. So I felt like I had to protect everybody from the threats by being hyper-vigilant, you know. These other people became unvigilant. And I said, it's my obligation to be vigilant for them. Which is exhausting, you know, having to be vigilant 24 hours a day. But reality needs no vigilance. Reality needs no vigilance. So existence requires constant vigilance. Reality requires no vigilance. So what you need to do to help people, because no matter how much vigilance you have in existence, it's never enough. Never enough. You're going to get caught somehow. So what you need to show is that there's a place where no vigilance is required. Reality, no vigilance is required. Show that to people, and so they can say, ah, that's what I really want. And again, those who are starting to wake up and free themselves from insanity, they won't go sour grapes. They will say, hey, this is what I want, you know? There's some people like on the golf course, if you do well, they just hate it. They absolutely hate it. They can't stand, you know, them not being better. And there are others who just love to play with somebody who's much better than them. Say, oh, that's fantastic, because I'm seeing it's possible. I'm seeing what's possible. And that's the way I am, you know. Even though it is intimidating, if you play with someone who's really good, you're saying, oh my gosh, I'm going to look terrible by comparison. But if their attitude is an understanding one, which most of good players are, they understand, it's like, oh, wow, 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 wow. You just sit there and you see, you know, hit the ball. And you just say, holy cow, this is possible. I can really do this. It is possible. And then you yourself start playing much better. It's called playing to the level of your competition, so to speak, which I am notorious for, unfortunately. I'd like to escape that because it's terrible. If I play with someone that's terrible, I will be worse than them to make them feel better. I will play with somebody who can't play at all, and I will play worse than them. So they will say, oh, I'm not so bad. He's even worse than me. That is my weakness, my mistake, you know, in life. I try to make people feel better by being worse off than them. And gosh, I've tried my whole life to turn this around because it's stupid. Totally wrong and stupid. You make people feel better by playing better than they are and showing them it's possible. Nobody, you know, to try and make someone feel better by being worse, I said, well, everybody's sick, I'll be even more sick than they are. You know, everybody's poor, I'll be even poorer than they are. Everybody's in despair, I'll even be in greater despair. And say, look, you're not the worst, I'm even worse off than you. And then they think, oh, okay, maybe I'm not so bad. You know, I've not been able to free myself from that entirely, you know. Amazing. Stupid. Because I don't want to see someone the worst than me. I want to see someone better than me, you know. But unfortunately, I came across situations that in my life where people, where literally my friendship was dependent on me being worse than they were. And I got into situations where people exploited me that way. And they told me, hey, you know, if you want my friendship, you got to be worse than me. And I said, okay, because I got too isolated. So we get into situations where we try to underachieve purposefully, sabotage ourselves, so we will do worse than someone else so they won't reject us, you know. So I'm working on that, you know. Gosh, that would be the greatest thing if I can finally shed that ridiculous stigma. Because like on Love Course, I know I can play very well, but I never do, you know. I don't want to play better than anyone else. I want someone else to be better so that they can experience that feeling like, hey, you know, I'm better. I figure, you know, it doesn't matter to me that much, but it is not good to do that because I'm not really being the best that I can be. Everyone should be the best that they can be. Everyone should be as free as they can be. Everyone should show, you know, the best, not the worst. So, I'd like to get in a great situation, and then I can, you know, show others, hey, look at this, you know, even though it's relatively great, not absolute, it's not a Passover, you know, at this yet, but still, to show others to reach higher, you know, reach all the way if you can, you know. I try to show people, well, you know, Ananda Maima, you know, I've came across her. And then also I came across the double that the etheric vampires produced. They produced doubles of Jesus, of Ramana, of everybody. They produced doubles, fakes, psychic fakes. They keep them animated. They're able to animate them. They're very sophisticated. You know, we're just touching the tip of the iceberg with all our technological wizardry of the sophistication that they have in deceiving us, really. We're just touching the tip, but we're getting there. We're rapidly developing that kind of sophistication. We can digitize people saying stuff they never said. And so we're reviewing it, and we think, oh, they did say this. We can digitize people doing things they never did. Historic figures, in other words. They never did. And we think, oh, you know, they did do this. We can literally revise all of history to something that never was digitally. And we'll think, you know, people don't know better. We'll just think, oh, that's the way it was. So we're able to give, you know, tremendous deception now. And those who are really very wedded to this deception are able to produce fake doubles of great teachers, great saviors, great sages, saints, gurus, etc., avatars, etc. And mislead even those who are very hard to mislead. Very hard to mislead. Even I was misled. But I was constantly evaluating, say, wait a minute. So I was kind of not sure. But at the same time, I'm trying to see, wait a minute, is this a deception? Let me see how clever they really are at this deception. So I kind of played along with it also. Then I found out, very clever, very wow. Wow, wow, wow. You know, it's like, which then undermines your faith in any Savior, right? But I was fortunate enough also to come across the real thing and realize, wow, there is a kingdom of heaven. Wow, there is a perfectly flawless reality. There's a death-free reality. And it's absolutely delightful, and it's absolutely unconcerned with these dreams of its destruction, absolutely unconcerned with destructivity, you know, with existence trying to destroy itself. It's not even concerned about that at all. Ananda Mahima didn't try to stop any destructivity. She just smiled, you know, just blissed out, completely blissed out. And was not looking for any particular experience or anything, and all this loss and destructivity going on around her. She just showed reality is untouched by this. I'm just showing you reality. So don't expect these great teachers to commiserate with us, to, you know, react to all this loss and death and destruction. No, that's not their purpose. Their purpose is to show you that reality is not affected by any loss at all. So she was here from 1896 to 1982. And during that time, you know, there was unbelievable loss in this world, more loss than there's ever been, all over the world, and including her home country of Bengal, then, which was then partitioned into East Bengal, which was then partitioned into East Pakistan, which then in 71 gained its independence as Bangladesh. Unbelievable suffering and misery the people have gone through. Famines, incredible famines. I think she was born during a famine time. Periodically, and then World War II famine in Bangladesh was just horrific. You know, 2 to 6 million people died, and then the War of Independence was horrific. Millions died. Floods, cyclones, and the floods, horrific. Horrific death, the suffering during the partition into East and West Bengal, and the partition to East Pakistan and West Pakistan, that partition, the refugee crises, and just, you know, it just nonstop, the cholera epidemics, the smallpox epidemics. I mean, that's just in our home country. Incredible loss and suffering there. And then you take it on, you know, India as a whole and all the suffering that India has gone through during the last, you know, 100 years plus. And then add that to that, the suffering of all, you know, the world wars. Okay. And then all the genocides that have taken place around the world and all the starving and, you know, around the world and all the epidemics and the sufferings and the Spanish influenza. I mean, she was there in the Spanish influenza decimated India. India was hit the hardest. And you know, it's not like she was unaware. She's right in the middle of it all. And yet it was as if none of it affected her in the slightest bit. It's like she wasn't even aware of it. She was aware of it, but not aware of it, okay? Because people would say, you know, my, everybody's dying from this. Can you do something? Please, please, please. And she would just not say anything, you know, and just keep smiling. Like, didn't even acknowledge it. But then they found out later that somehow all sorts of help came in some way. But, you know, it wasn't... And they said, she did do a lot on the subtle inner level, so to speak, but her attitude was such that it doesn't matter. None of this matters. None of this matters. And she'd have, children of her devotees would die, and one of them fell down a well and died, and you know, they said, how come you didn't stop it? You knew what would happen. She goes, yeah, I knew what would happen, but that's the play that one is engaged in, the loyalty to loss that one is engaged in, that's how they want to play that play. So it's not, you know, it's not my purpose here to step in and stop loss. My purpose here is to show you that reality is not worried about loss. You know, that's great witnessing, great witnessing. And it's just, you know, well, yeah, it's just life and death here in existence. It's all the same to reality. Reality makes no differentiation between life and death here, none. It's all the same, meaning nothing. doesn't affect reality one bit. The delight of reality is not affected one bit, and she just kept shining that delight into the world, reminding us of this fact that that's real teaching, that's real witnessing, that is profound, great witnessing. Someone who's aware of reality here, you know, aware of it, is the best witnessing you can possibly have here, the best. Just shining that assurance into the world at all times that no matter what happens here, it has no bearing on reality, it doesn't affect it at all. And just showing us that. So you cannot, don't expect those teachers to respond to loss. That's not their purpose. Their purpose is not to respond to it. And if people insisted that you weep, she would weep, you know, just because they insisted on it. And then when they'd stop insisting on it, boom, you know, the bliss was there. And then people realized that the bliss was always there. And she was just acting out tears for their own benefit. But, you know, and then when, you know, sometimes that would happen. So that is the greatest witnessing. That is what we need. That is what this world needs, is that type of witnessing. I'm telling you for sure. When people ask me, how can you know, you know, the gurus, the great saviors, and what are you hoping for? How can you recognize it? Well, it's completely obvious. How can it not be completely obvious? One who is simply completely uninterested and unaffected by any loss whatsoever is a real witness, and one who shines the light of reality into this world under all circumstances, no matter what is happening. She said, let anything come, doesn't matter to me, doesn't matter what comes at all, let anything, whatever comes, let it come, you know. So and of course she was aware of the future and even didn't react to that. I mean, the loss that is coming in the future, you know, is horrific. The brutal suffering that is coming on this planet because of the etheric vampires and the psychic parasites and the reptilians and what they are fostering, the addiction and escalation they're fostering here on this planet, is so severe, is so terrible. You know, the loss here is going to be catastrophic. And yet she never, ever shed a tear for that either, you know, which is amazing, which is, I hope that she would. I'd say, you know, gosh, how come, you know, you're not at least have some compassion for the future? And now she still said, well, you know, whatever happens in the future too, that doesn't affect me in the slightest bit. Doesn't affect reality in the slightest bit. I'm still completely blissful. And so we wrongly think that because she was that way, it means that everything's going to be fine in the future. Same with Jesus, same with Ramana. We think, oh, surely they would have warned us. Surely they would have told us, oh, you know, my gosh, it's horrible, you know. Well, in some ways they did, but sure, we think surely they would react to it. We're looking for a reaction, and there wasn't any reaction to it. So we wrongly think that things are going to be fine in the future. That's the mistake that people make. Say, well, you know, Ramana would have told us if the future was going to be, you know, full of, you know, catastrophic, brutal repression and suffering and death and misery, of loss of all types and very intense. Surely Ramana would have warned us, you know, all the tsunamis and, you know, earthquakes and famines and, you know, pestilence and everything that's coming on in the world, and, you know, galactic superwave and the sun going into a red giant, and, you know, on and on and on and on. It is endless. Surely they would have said, ah, you gotta, you know, escape it, escape it, escape it, escape it. Now, their purpose was to say, look, whatever happens in existence, come what may, makes absolutely zero difference to reality. Doesn't affect reality in any way, doesn't affect the bliss of reality in any way. And that teaching gives us the courage and conviction to escape this stuff, you know. It's not that they want us to go through it, but they know the way to escape it is to realize it has no effect on reality. That is the only way we can escape it, if we get that conviction. Because if we don't have that conviction, we will defend against it and we'll fight against it and we'll get pulled into it and we'll get pulled under. But if we have that conviction, it doesn't affect reality in any way, then we can accept the Passover. accept the Passover principle and let it pass us by. Let it pass over us and not touch us. But only if we have that conviction. How do we get that conviction? Because these great teachers, Jesus and Ramana and Ananda Mayama and others, okay, too, shown the light of reality into this world and saying, look, doesn't matter what loss takes place, doesn't affect reality one bit, not at all, zero. And that gives us the conviction that this is true, and therefore we apply the Passover principle. But internally, those teachers have been warning us, because they have warned me. They have shown me what's to come. They're not denying it, but their purpose here is to give us that conviction. So you're not going to see them reacting to it. You're not going to see that. And we're looking for a reaction. You know, even if they tell us, we're still looking for a reaction, saying, if this is true, surely you would be reacting to it, right? We're thinking, we outsmart ourselves, and we're really stupid, waiting for their reaction. Where's the reaction? And we don't see it. We say, oh, okay, it must be bogus. Everything must be fine. And you get these backward gurus that are saying, well, everything must be fine in the future, therefore I can be happy now. You know, they're basing their happiness on this delusional idea of existence, that there's some golden age utopia, that peace on earth and all this stuff, and everything, you know, is great. And they're saying that's why they're going to be happy, because this utopia is coming. Those are not the real teachers. The real teachers tell you that existence is ceaseless suffering, that it's ceaseless conflict, it is ceaseless loss, and yet all of that ceaseless suffering, misery, loss has no effect on reality and never will. And reality is absolutely blissful and delightful, and they show that to us. Those are the real teachers of truth, teachers of reality. And they seem to be cruel, you know, because if someone's dying, there's someone's miserable suffering, and they're still completely blissed out. And you think, how come, you know, you're not all perturbed by this? Where's your compassion? But they know that real compassion is to give conviction to us. That's because that's the only thing that works. And you can also get conviction through inner experiences. You can get that too, but both are very helpful. How many realize this principle that I'm speaking about here? Everyone can realize it. But it's super important to realize it. Super important. And it's hard for us. It's really hard. It's hard for me to accept good fortune, you know, when everyone else is suffering. I know. I know everybody's, you know, suffering. Drought is all over and continues to be. And people are starving. I know the world isn't. People are dying, you know, all sorts of horrible stuff is going on. I know that, very aware of it. In the future, I know the future and what's going to come, so it's like, oh my gosh, should I just succumb to empathy, you know? No, that is not what it's called for. Opposite. You know, what do you call it? In other words, feel what they feel. Feel the loss with them. Misery loves company. Feel it. No, that is not helpful. Because where there do you give anyone conviction that reality is untouched by this? You don't give them at all. What you're doing is reinforcing the belief that reality is touched by this, which then merely enmeshes them even worse in their addiction cycles. Addiction escalation of all their negative cycles get reinforced when you empathize. Really. Very bad. Ma did not empathize. Some called her heartless because she didn't empathize. She just shined the love and stability and bliss and delight of reality. She just shined it. Just kept shining it, you know. And then some would gradually, they would say, wow, wait a minute. You know, this is what I really want. I thought I wanted the empathy, but what I really want is the reassurance. So, gosh, we would be absolutely blessed by anyone in the world who's really like this. There's some that are going, and you know, towards that. Maybe there are some that are already like that. I don't know. It's desperately needed. It is desperately needed. You know, I can't give you, you know, I can't do a documentary on the life of Nanda Maima because the ego has, the defense systems of existence have caused enough distortion and twisting, etc. And things, with all the different changes and loss that's happened, we thinking we've lost that reassurance that she brought. It's not reverberating contemporarily like it should. It's not. It's like it's down to, you know, incredible, dwindled so fast because the world really reacted in a defensive way to it, and got all these imitators that sprang out of the woodwork. You had the psychic, the etheric vampires producing psychic doubles and contacting people pretending to be her. And, you know, the defenses of existence always are active, very active. What we need is someone contemporary right now. It's fresh, you know, that's fresh, that's here now, that the ego, the defenses of existence have not been able to muddy the water, so to speak, so much. Really need that. So I'm not going to waste my time doing a documentary on my Ma, even though I could do, you know, a fabulous job, but it would take me months and months and months and burn me out, and nobody would watch it. Tell you the truth, nobody really would watch it, and they wouldn't get it. They wouldn't get it. The response to a historic person tends toward in certain ways that it is not the right, not what we're looking for, not at all. Not at all. I got to tell you that for sure. I've been heavily involved with Nanda Maima and producing all sorts of stuff that people don't even know about, really. I was one of the driving forces towards popularizing her in the modern culture. And I've been observing the responses for the last 15 years. And responses are simply not there at all. Hardly there at all. No, it's they're not getting the essence of it at all, and so it's just muddying the waters. It's futile. Doesn't work, which is why the defenses of existence would love for me to produce a documentary, because it would waste my time, waste other people's time, and just muddy the waters even more. Because you have to have a living person. You have to have a savior, a sage, a guru, avatar. You have to have a living one right now that you can see, that's here now, either in person or like this virtually, and feel the assurance right now. Historical assurance it loses its potency, and then people can react in ways that think, oh, you know, just it misses the mark. It totally misses the mark, because there's nothing like having someone right there now where you're suffering loss, where people are suffering loss, where everything is falling apart and decaying, and to see that they are not reacting to it at all. You have to see that right now. And then that brings the conviction, oh my gosh, you know, because in the past we can say, well, things were different, now the loss is a different, you know, or we're suffering differently or something, and, you know, who knows what the response would have been at this time. So it's so crucial to have someone now who's, again, absolutely not reacting to loss, who looks right through past loss of any type, just keeps their eye on reality steady. That brings an enormous conviction that no documentary can bring that conviction. Believe me, I could produce a stunning documentary. Stunning. Absolutely gorgeous and stunning. And you know what? I might get 1,000 views over the next 5 years. And maybe out of those views, maybe nobody would have the real response that brings true conviction. Nobody. Zero. So it would be just waste everyone's time. Really would. And we say, well, maybe that's better than nobody coming. It's not. It's not even better than that. It's just a waste of time. It's a futile, it's sort of a grand gesture of futility, you know? I've already wasted years and years and years and years and years thinking maybe I could do that, because she's dead, and I felt the, she's passed on, the body passed on, the conviction that she brought was rapidly diminishing, dissipating. I said, oh my gosh, I gotta stop this from dissipating, because it's so important. And I found out you can't stop it from dissipating. You cannot stop it from dissipating. That conviction, you know, is super important. But it's more important to talk about it in this way than it is to produce a documentary. It's more important. Because at least we're setting ourselves up for the opportunity, right? To come across this conviction at some point. We will at some point, I don't know when. And when we come across it, then boom, we know it. Just, oh my gosh, here it is. And it strikes you, you know, like a sonic boom. And it reverberates through you, your whole being, all your energy bodies are reverberating with this conviction, and you're transformed, you know. What is transformed? Your appearance and your conviction, your beliefs are transformed. Just like that, if you're ready, you know, it reverberates. I saw somebody in a thrift store once, an old Indian lady, and accompanied by her daughter. And I asked her daughter, they were leaving the store, I left the store, I saw her, and I asked the daughter, can you ask your mom, she saw Anandamayi once, didn't she? I can tell. I can really tell, for sure. I know it for a fact. And she went and asked her mom, and she came back to me and said, oh my gosh, how did you know? It's incredible. I said, because it's still reverberating. I could feel it. She said, yeah, she saw her one time. One time. And she sat in the presence of Anandamayi Ma one time. And she said it transformed her life, and it's been with her entire life, and it's still reverberating. And I, seeing this lady in a store, I suddenly saw her. So I said, oh my gosh, that lady has been in the presence of Anandamayi Ma. I knew it. Because it was still reverberating. And there's a peace. There's something about her, a conviction. There was an inner conviction in this lady that said, she said, I know all is well with reality. I know it. The outward appearance, there was nothing special, but there was this sort of a subtle conviction with this lady. And I saw it, and I said, you know what? I'm positive. Only sitting with Anandamayi Ma, you know, I just thought, well, you could sit with Ramana and the same thing, but this lady, I felt it was Anandamayi Ma she sat with, and she told her daughter, yeah. I don't think she'd ever told her daughter that. I'm not sure, because the daughter asked her, and she said, you know, tell the gentleman that this is very true, that when I was younger, maybe a girl or something, she says, I had the opportunity to meet and sit with Anandamayi Ma, and it just completely changed my life. My conviction blew me away, just absolutely. And she says, to this very day, I'll never, ever, ever forget it. She says, absolutely unforgettable. Because nothing else brings that conviction except one who is absolutely 100% certain that no loss is affecting reality and will ever, not only right now, but ever. And she had that perfect 100% conviction from seeing, direct seeing, direct experiencing. It was not just conviction, belief, it was direct experiencing of reality, pouring that conviction pouring into the world, overflowing into this world. And when you have the opportunity to be in the presence of that overflowing conviction, you will never forget it, and that your conviction will be changed forever. You won't be the same. Never. No way. And We are impoverished in this world right now because we don't have quite that level. I don't want to disrespect anybody in this world right now, because there's some who are doing great work and helping our conviction for sure. There really are. But, you know, that conviction that Ananda Maima or Ramana Maharshi had was the conviction that no loss can ever touch reality in any way, ever. Never has, never will, no matter what. If everybody gets tortured, you know, indefinite torture, still bliss has an unaffecting reality, and she was willing to share that with all of us instead of reacting to all the torment, because God knows the torment that her own people went through, have gone through over the last century, has just been epic. I don't know if any people have suffered more over the last 100 years than the people of Bangladesh, really. Just awful, you know? So I guess she was born in the right place to show this, because she was born during a famine when just horrible starvation. And you know, there were starvation there means you're just sitting in the street and, you know, dying in the street, and nobody does a thing, can do a thing, because nobody else has any food. There were no safety nets, nothing. You just sit there and you die, and if you sit in a field and you die, and then the buzzards and crows and vultures strip your carcass. There's nobody to even bury you. You know, I mean, it's just mind-boggling what has happened, the loss of all types that happened in Bangladesh. And here she was born into Bangladesh, in Kiora, near Agartala and Kasba, kind of triangle there, and in a little rural, super poor, thatched hut, dirt floor, like the villages are there, in the midst of a famine, and then went through the century almost of 86 years of nonstop tragedy of that country. And just horrific stuff. World War II, 2 to 6 million people starved to death there. You know, I mean, it's a Holocaust, and it's never even talked about. Could be even 6 million people lost their lives to simply famine and the disease and sickness that grabs you, you know, when you're so weakened. And the displacement of the people, the horrible displacement, and the massacres, and on 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 and on. And she was born there. That's her homeland. And so what better place to showcase that reality is untouched by loss than to be born in a place where they suffered so much tragedy and loss and still radiate this total blissful unconcern, showing that reality is untouched by that. So, you know, so that may be the reason why she was born there. I know everybody's giving all these reasons that there's, you know, lineage and all this stuff, but in my opinion, she was born there because it was the perfect place to showcase that reality is untouched by loss of any kind, because her home country was touched with loss of every kind over the last century. Every kind. Loss from sickness, loss from famine, loss from floods, loss from war, loss from revolution, loss from genocide, loss from atrocities, loss of every sickness of every kind, loss of displacement. Just horrible. And let me add this to you, you know, why not put the cherry on top? Now, this has not been shared very, very often, ever, but I will share it with you now. She had an ashram right next to the Kali Mandir in Ramna Park, okay? Suryawadi Udan Park now, it's called, near the eternal flame and the reflecting pool of the martyrs of the revolution. The Ramna Kali Mandir had been there for a long, long time. For some, you know, one of the oldest temples in what's now Bangladesh, and she built an ashram. It was an ashram was built for her right next to this mandir in what the northeast corner of it. It's part of a compound. And there was like a lot of families living there, like what, 400 families or something, living in this big compound. And during the Operation Searchlight of the invasion of East Pakistan by West Pakistan, there was a terrible massacre there. And over 100 people were executed by the West Pakistani army. And the high priest was massacred along with almost all the men, many women, many children, and their corpses were piled up and burned. And it was one of the worst atrocities you can imagine what took place there. The Kali Mandir was burned, her ashram was burned, and the widows were, the young girls were taken off and never seen again. The widows were driven out and forced to flee, you know, to India, relocate. They lost all their possessions, they lost everything. And the place was absolutely destroyed, and then the bulldozers were brought in and they bulldozed the entire complex into nothing. This was her own ashram, her first ashram, her prime, you know, in Dhaka, in the Surawardi Park, Ramna Park area, Shahbag precinct in Dhaka. And this was her, this is where she started her whole thing. I mean, her thing, her coming out was there in this beautiful park, a Shahbag area, Shahbag Park. Gorgeous, beautiful area, peaceful area. And this Kali Mandir, a center of worship for the Hindus in that area for a time immemorial. Her little ashram was started there, and all these wonderful memories there of so much grace and beauty suddenly turned into a massacre ground. And they had to recite, you know, things that were, and were bayoneted and shot in their mouths, and it was just horrible, horrible, murderous massacre of these people, of these worshipful devotees of Anandamayi Ma, massacred. And she was, of course, in India at this time, 1971, and I never have heard a single mention of this from her or anybody that was associated with her, you know, as if it, you know, it never happened. I'm thinking, you know, wow, why? What? These are just, you would think that she would have saved them, right? Did not. She saved, you know, why? Okay, well, maybe this is the ultimate proof of her proving herself to the ultimate. That even when her devotees were massacred in the most horrible way, their corpses piled up on top of each other, and gasoline was poured on and burned, and children that had lost their parents were thrown into this fire, and their skulls stacked up around the area, you know, even when this took place, her bliss did not change in the slightest bit. And that she continued to pour out the assurance that reality is completely untouched by loss of any kind. That, you know, that is simply mind-blowing, you know, mind-blowing. I've struggled with this because this is not well known. And people, I've never heard it really talked about. You know, I had to dig into this. I discovered it. I said, are you kidding me? I couldn't believe it. Because she knew, of course she knew that this was going to take place. She could see the future very clearly. And, you know, maybe she sent word. I believe she may have sent word for people to leave that area, and they didn't. I believe she did do that. I think I came across some mention of that, like she did send word to say, you know, you all need to leave now. And people said, no, we will stay here and take care of your ashram, and we will, you know, this is our home. We were not going to leave. I believe that did take place. So she warned them. But she didn't react to the loss. When it took place, she did not go into mourning. She did not tear her hair out. She did not say, this is terrible. I'm devastated by this. My own devotees got massacred. No. I don't come across any reaction to it whatsoever in all the historical writings of those who were, you know, observing her at all times. didn't cause her to lose the slightest bit of bliss. She never reacted to it in any way. Now, there may be those who will correct me in this, but from my overall understanding and great study of the whole situation, no. She continued to radiate the assurance that reality is completely unaffected by loss of any kind, even loss of the head priests and those who were taking care of the the flame there and protecting her original ashram where so many miracles took place and all this stuff, even when they got massacred and the horrible loss among the families, you know, and the widows and the children, you know, just heartbreaking, awful. And there's still no memorial of that situation there. I guess she never asked for any memorial or never asked for anything to be done about it really at all, because that's not her purpose. Her purpose was to radiate the assurance that no loss of any type affects reality whatsoever. So being born in Bangladesh and going through the terrible suffering of her homeland, the people there, and then her own devotees going through this horrific situation, and before that, during the partition into East and West Bengal, and terrible suffering, there were suffering massacres at that time, and then the partition into from India into East Pakistan, there was horrible suffering then and displacement, horrible. And she got many people out, it is true, but at the same time, the people suffered horribly. Gosh, you know, I mean, literally, they had to leave the country. And she lost her passport. I mean, she couldn't return to East Pakistan. She couldn't return to her homeland. She wasn't allowed in. So I don't think she returned. She never returned, as far as I know. I don't know in later life if she was returned, but there was for a while there. You know, you had to leave and you couldn't return. And so she warned a lot of people to get out of there. And I heard that she got all her devotees out, but obviously not the ones in the, Kali Mandir Ananda Mahima Ashram compound. Those stayed. And they paid the price with their lives. More than that, with the disruption of their families and scattered to the ends of the earth. Never talked about in the narrative of her life. Never talked about. But it should be, because that's the ultimate proof. It should be talked about, because that's the ultimate proof that she was simply pouring out. She was totally one with reality and telling us, assuring us that reality is not touched by loss of any kind, no matter what it is. And of course, she knows that all her devotees are going to, you know, lose their life in some way at some point. And I'm sure she's aware of the atrocities that come in the future here, which are, you know, unbelievable. And that, again, didn't react to it in the slightest bit. I'm sure she's aware of the suffering that I've gone through in my life, of everybody, any devotee, you know, and, you know, didn't react to that in any way. So no matter what, she didn't react. No matter what the suffering, you're not going to get any response other than bliss from her or from the great gurus like Ramana Maharshi, Jesus Christ, the same thing. I mean, I'm sure Jesus Christ knew the fate of his disciples, the 12, you know, that went out carrying the gospel all around. And, you know, they all got martyred, right? Pretty much so, except maybe for John. They all met, you know, pretty gruesome, horrible fates, you know, being crucified upside down, on and on and on and on and on. Horrible, right? I'm sure he knew that. But again, his purpose is to show, gives the assurance, even his own crucifixion, he had perfect assurance that this does not affect reality in any way. You know, that might even be the ultimate, you know, example. I don't know. Which is more difficult, for your own body be crucified and show everyone that this does not affect reality in any way, and just to have that perfect assurance, You know, that is, you know, amazing. Or to see your devotees massacred, you know, that, you know, and you're perfectly okay and they're being massacred, you know, that's awfully tough too, isn't it? It's awfully tough too. It's one thing for you to die, but to see all your dear, loved devotees with their families that she was part of, she was like their daughter. You know, she was one with their families, and to see those families massacred, you know, to know that they're, you know, and to not respond at all, you know, is amazing. It's amazing. It's another type of witnessing. You know, I don't think we need to judge which is greater. They're both profound, both very profound. You know, and for me, I think survivor's guilt is tougher to deal with. You know, you say, why didn't they take me instead? You know, that's just me. But you know, what do I know? I know it is tough. Survivor's guilt is, you know, tough, and it didn't affect her in the slightest bit. Her husband died of smallpox, the worst kind. Suffered horribly. She never showed any diminishment of her bliss at all. She went quiet. She became somber because everybody else wanted her to be somber. But you could tell she was still completely in bliss as he lay there dying, you know. And she, the last hour, she took the worst of the suffering off of him. She gave some type of massage, touched her hands on him, and all pain was gone. He said all pain left him. But up until that point, you know, he was suffering horribly. And of course she could have healed him like that. Didn't do it, because that's not her purpose. Her purpose was here to show us that reality is untouched by loss. So if she's healing, people think, oh, you know, she was concerned that the death of her husband would bring her grief. So she healed him for her own selfish reasons. She didn't want to suffer. So no, she didn't do that. Her number one devotee, Baishi, he too died fairly early. She had no grief then. She never showed any grief at the death of anyone. Never. No matter how close they were to her. Never showed any grief. If it does, it was crocodile tears. It was simply because everybody asked her to cry, and so she'd shed all these tears. She also would cry when other people were hysterical. She'd start crying even more hysterical until they'd stop. Whoa, Ma, she says, you know, stop crying. You were afraid you're going to die. You're hysterical. And then, oh, she'd stop, and they'd be completely blissful. And then they'd realize later, ah, I was hysterical, and you distracted me from my hysteria by you acting out hysteria. And she'd say, yeah, that's true. They say, were you really hysterical? She says, no, not really. I was just doing this little trick for you to help you out, you know. So these are stories, you know. Maybe this is better than doing a big blah, 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 blah documentary, you know, because I can pass these stories on to you here. I studied her life. Every account of her life, I studied and studied and studied. I knew it backwards and forwards, you know. And, you know, and then I threw away all the books. I don't have them anymore. I cannot reference them, but I've internalized it, you know. I understand what she did. What she did was she just showed us that reality is untouched by loss. That is the greatest witnessing you can possibly have. And she did it in so many ways, you know, so many ways. Being a loss of every type, you know. When Mahatma Gandhi, you know, was assassinated, you know, they were close. They met several times. And when all this, you know, national convulsions took place, you know, didn't bother her. Her bliss was still pure, radiant, untouched. People say, Ma, you know, did you hear the bad news? Say, oh, yeah, I know. She already knew everything that took place. She said, yeah, I know. And, well, you know, do you have anything to say? And said, well, that was, you know, his karma. That was his karma. Meaning, that came from his whatever vestiges of loyalty to loss, you know, that he still had, that acted out in that way, you know. And so she says, you know, it's okay. It's okay. Let it play. She said, "Let the play of loss dance all around me. I myself remain completely untouched and unchanged by it." That's what she said. That was her confession to Yogananda. Yogananda said, "Tell us something about yourself, please, 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 because you're ceaselessly in the highest bliss." She said, "I've never seen any woman like that, maybe never even any man. No, you know, how can you, some are in bliss, highest bliss sometimes, but you are in the highest bliss all the time, no matter what. How do you do it? What is this?" And she says, you know, that basically, even though the dance of Maya, of loss, this hypothetical scenario of change in reality, of loss, trying to annihilate itself, dances all around me in all different ways. Even though the dance goes on forever, she says, what I am remains untouched, unchanged by it. I am in ceaseless bliss. Meaning reality, what I am is reality, is what we all are. There's only one reality, not two, just one, and we are all that. And she's just reminding us that it is untouched by this dance of loss. So she was in the midst of all this dance of loss for 84 years, in a place where it's just full of the most raw loss, you know. I mean, India, Bangladesh, I mean, come on. I mean, we're talking about some raw, raw stuff there. You know, we're talking about, you know, real reality TV, as it were, right? It's unadorned. I mean, it is brutal, brutal, of all types of loss. The human parade there, people are dropping. I mean, she spent a lot of time in Calcutta, and people are just dying on the streets, as Mother Teresa, showed to the Western world. But this is something that was, you know, it's been known for a long time, and we're appalled by it, you know. Oh my God, the poverty, the misery, the suffering. She was there all the time in Calcutta, Kolkata, as it's now said. And again, the bliss is undiminished, untouched by it. The flood of, 1974 in Bangladesh? Was it 71 or 74? I'm not sure. You know, that the West Concert for Bangladesh in Madison Square Garden, George Harrison did this great stuff. Beautiful soul, beautiful spirit, George Harrison. And you know, he you know, brought this compassion up of the West. But again, Nanda Mayama was there the whole time in that you know, in India, and her bliss is undiminished. No show of compassion, just bliss. So bliss is the real teaching. Compassion is not the real teaching. It's still the ego-based, loss-based teaching. But no one can say that you shouldn't be compassionate. But it can, you know, it is not the highest witnessing we're capable of. Let's put it that way. If we can't witness the highest witnessing, then let us witness as high as we can. Okay? And so, however, our witnessing to existence, the best we can do, that is the best we can do. So there's no reason to criticize that at all. But it's super important to find the highest witnessing. Super important. Super important. Because without that, you're still lost. You're still lost. You're still reinforcing the fact that you believe loss touches reality. And it does not. It does not. Now, Jesus Christ showed us by his own crucifixion that loss does not touch reality. He says, "You want to crucify my body? Go ahead." He didn't give any defense. He said, "Go ahead." You know, Pilate said, "Say something. Save yourself, man. You didn't do anything wrong. You're crazy. Why are you allowing yourself to be crucified? My gosh, I'll set you free this moment." He said, "No, no. Go ahead. I'm here to show you something. Go ahead." And they crucified him, and then he rose again and said, "Look, okay, I came here to show you something. Did you see that I was not concerned at all, that the crucifixion of my body, the body that you called Jesus, in no way was reality concerned about that, in no way. Because the murderer on one side of him said, 'Why don't you save yourself? If you're who you say you are, save yourself.' Jesus said, no, 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 no. I came to show you that reality is not concerned about loss of any kind, including the loss of the body you call Jesus that was previously witnessing to the, it's unconcerned with loss. Even the crucifixion of that body is not concerned with that either. Even that, that is a super powerful witnessing that has helped many get on the right path, helped many. Super powerful witnessing. And there have been other witnesses in different ways, like Ramana had throat cancer, and I believe he had throat cancer, and Nisargadatta Guru also had, I think, throat cancer. And they, you know, said, what are you worried about? Reality is not touched by throat cancer of this body. It's not bothered by it in the slightest bit. What are you freaking out about? And they said, we're going to lose you. I said, yeah, but it's more important that I show you that reality is untouched by any threat of loss of any kind. It's very important. So I think Ramana had Parkinson's too, and you know, whatever, you know, came, didn't matter to him. Let anything come. That's and my ma said too. Her favorite saying is, you know, let anything come. Doesn't matter to me. Totally unconcerned, whatever comes in it. Let existence bring whatever it wants to bring. Doesn't matter. Completely unconcerned, even to the point of all the types of loss or country in Bangladesh, India, and then her devotees, etc. Let it come, let whatever existence, however existence wants to dance, let it dance. She's not concerned about the dance at all. Let it dance in any way. And she just says, good news, reality is untouched by it. What I am, what is, reality is untouched by dreams of non-isness, of losing that isness. It's untouched. Untouched. So, you know, in some ways I'm doing a real documentary here by just sharing this conviction that I got from these teachers, from Jesus, from Ramana, and from Ananda Maima, the conviction and, you know, thanks to all those who have shared this conviction over the millennia, with Jesus especially, that have shared this conviction, you know, that they had, the early Christians had this conviction that blew people away. They're blown away. They were sent into the Colosseum in front of these wicked and etheric, parasitic, reptilian infected, poor, you know, entities here, my personas, as it were, who were there in the Colosseum to see these Christians being eaten by lions, all the while indulging in drugs and orgies and providing all the stimulus that the etheric parasites demand of them. And these Christians would go in there, you know, and here's these, you know, lions and wild beasts coming to devour them. And they'd just sit there, you know, and say, I have perfect conviction that the loss of my body doesn't affect reality in the slightest bit. Doesn't matter. Go ahead. And the etheric parasite reptilian infected entities of Rome at that time, these wicked, decadent, you know, depraved, addiction, escalation, enmeshed personas there that were there to be stimulated by this mass, you know, horrible sacrifice of these Christians, they would be freaked out. They'd say, what's going on? I'm not getting any stimulation from this. It's revolting to me. And they found it revolting. They hated it. Eventually it was stopped because it didn't provide the stimulation they were looking for. It revolted them. And they said, don't bring these Christians in here anymore. We can't stand it. It's freaking us out. You know, bring somebody in who's going to scream and wail and cry and fight for their life. That's what they wanted. They wanted someone there that would fight for their life. They wanted loss. They wanted to see somebody defending something they felt that loss was significant. But the Christian, with the conviction that Jesus brought to them, they would simply, in great bliss, they were in great bliss, they just sit there and say, doesn't matter, I'm in paradise already. Do whatever you want to do with this body, doesn't make any difference to me. And that, you know, had a profound effect on the Roman Empire and brought about the Roman Empire's collapse, actually, eventually, is people just started, you know, freaking out, and they persecuted them. They tried to kill all the Christians. They weren't able to, and it gradually spread. And finally, Constantine said, you know, hey, maybe they got some kind of special power. They're not afraid of death. I want to convert my army to Christianity, which is why Christianity spread like in that way. Constantine just thought they had no fear of death. What better religion to teach his army than that? You know, but that he missed it. He didn't understand it. They said that loss of any kind doesn't affect reality in any way. And that was, Jesus Christ proved it to them. And they had that tremendous conviction. It's not that they wanted to go out and kill people. No, because why would they do that? They were pacifists, you know. But Constantine, what he did was he took the part of it, the part of being fearless in battle and unafraid of death, and he twisted it and then presented that to his true and to the Roman Empire and spread it throughout Europe. So then you had this, because the Romans had faced many tribes and peoples in different places who had different means of trying to overcome the fear of death, so that, you know, they would drink intoxicants and do all these rituals and whatever. And they'd get themselves into this mindset where they were not afraid of death, and they just charge right into being, you know, the elite Roman legions and be hacked to death. And they, you know, the Roman legions were like, whoa, you know, wow, you know, this is really something. These people are crazy. They're not even afraid of it hardly at all. But they were afraid. But they, you know, had this temporary manicness. They'd go into a berserk. They go berserk. There's ways to use drugs and various things, magical spells, to go berserk. And they go berserk, you know, it frightened the Roman legions. Now Constantine realized that he's facing these what he called them barbarians, who were go berserk, and he needed some way for his legions to be strengthened. And so they, you know, they use a Christian flag, and he somehow indoctrinated his legions into believing that, you know, if they died, they would be with Christ in paradise or something, you know, which is a typical thing. It's been used, you know, Islam has used that too, as a way to get warriors to be fearless, unafraid of death, to conquer. But that's a complete distortion of Christianity. It's got nothing to do with it. It's just a way to try and make your armies more invincible, is what it is. And so you have all these people who converted to that, you know, seeing these soldiers are like fearless, they're not afraid to die, and they think, wow, I wish I was that fearless too, you know. But that is not the real teaching of Christ at all. So you have the spread of what I call pagan Christianity, not really understanding the purpose of it. It's different than those who early Christians who really had that conviction, see, that Jesus was showing us by his crucifixion that reality is totally unconcerned by loss of any kind. And if you understood that, you don't need to go through any loss anymore. You don't need to be martyred or crucified or anything. If you just accept, wow, this example was sufficient. If you accept that example is sufficient, you could literally have the world pass you by. You can literally ascend or be passed over completely. That's all you need, because that example, you know, showed. It showed what needed to be showed. It showed absolute certainty to those who saw that reality is not threatened by any loss of any kind at all. But instead, it got turned into the idea of trying to have armies be fearless to go out and slaughter other armies. And so you had this whole culture of warriors, you know, who felt that because they were fighting for Christ that they wouldn't die. You know, they had some superpower. And this, you know, in battle at that time, literally battles, who won the battles were those who had the greater conviction that they could not suffer defeat and death would not touch them. And when you have a whole legion that has this conviction, it breaks the spell of the other other side, and they start panicking because they say, oh my gosh, death is going to get me, because this other side is completely convinced that it can't touch them. You know, so Constantine saw ways, practical ways, to use Christianity for conquering. You know, which that is not the right perspective on Christianity at all. Not at all. And yet there are other saints who had the right perspective on it, you know, so there's kind of like two Christianities, one that, you know, spread the right perspective, the right conviction was spread, and the other that was spread through forced conversion, through seeing the fearlessness in battle and thinking there was some kind of special power that enables you to attack others safely and seize their lands and, you know, go on the crusades and go through battles and just, you know, going through these horrible battles and wars and with assurance that you're going to win because somehow you're fighting for Jesus, so how can you lose? You know, that's not what Jesus came to show us at all. He came to show us that reality is not threatened by loss of any kind, not even the crucifixion of his body, not even that. Okay? And so you get different peoples get this conviction in different ways, too. Okay? It was given for so many to get this conviction from Jesus Christ that, you know, others get it from Ramana Maharshi, others could get it from Ananda Maima, others could get it from Buddha, others can get it from Muhammad, others can get it from different teachers of all different types. You know, however they can get this conviction. It's not for me to say how someone gets this conviction. You know, who knows? Who knows how it can come? Who knows? Who knows? But for me, you know, I get it through three major sources: Jesus Christ, Ramana Maharshi, and Ananda Maima. With Ananda Maima being the most recent one. I think Ramana died in 1950, and Ananda Maima died in 1984, so she was much more contemporary with me. And the loss, again, that she externally, that she suffered by, you know, those around her and everything, and affecting her in any way, for me is like, wow, very profound, my gosh. You know, survivor guilt. I mean, what if the whole world, everybody's massacred and you're alive and it doesn't affect you in any way? You know, wow. Wow. That's an eye-opener, you know, that reverberates. And there's a tendency to think, well, maybe she's got no hope. And then you say, no, that's not true. That's not true. But there's something else going on. It's a witnessing. Coming here to witness to the world. Only for that purpose. To witness, to reassure us. That's the only purpose. Reassure us. She didn't need any teaching. She didn't need any learning. She already knew reality perfectly well. She said she knew it before she was born. She said she during her life and after her life, she said she's going to know it. She said she's always known it. Always known reality. And only came here to assure us that loss of any kind, reality is untouched by loss of any type, ever. You name it. Doesn't matter. That's the only reason she came. To reassure us of that. No other reason. Reality doesn't need to change anything in existence. Doesn't need to come in here and do something to change loss, to mitigate loss, to stop loss, to prevent loss. Doesn't need to do anything like that. Just needs to tell us, hey, this dream you're dreaming, it'll never affect reality, so don't worry about it. Drop the dream. It is, you know, it's useless. You can keep it if you want, you can drop it if you want. Doesn't matter either way. But just be assured that if you keep it, no matter what loss you've seen, experience, or whatever anyone who keeps dreaming experiences, doesn't affect reality in any way. Just be assured of that. And then see where you go with that, you see. And what happens is, you say, wow, if it doesn't affect reality, what in the heck am I doing this for in the first place? All right? What in the heck am I doing this for anyway? It's crazy. I'm not getting anything out of it. It's nuts. It's futile. It's useless. You first have to ask, well, if that's the case, why did God bring about this scenario of loss? The answer is God did not bring about this scenario of loss. We did. We're dreaming it. We are imagining it. We are projecting it. We're hypothesizing it for ourselves. It's like hypothetical scenario. We're hypothesizing it. It's a what if. We're saying, wow, what if we could annihilate ourselves? Well, we can't. So what are we doing continuing to say what if we could when we know we can't? And Ananda Maimon is just saying, look, you can't do it. Reality is untouched by any of your attempts to annihilate it. So if you want to give it up, feel free to do so, because you'll be welcome home with open arms, and you will realize, oh my gosh, reality is completely immaculate. It's never been touched, completely immaculate. So why not give it up? I mean, it's the only thing a reasonable person would do would be to drop it. If we don't drop it, we're just being silly, really, very silly. And of course, those who want to keep it up, they don't come across these great reassurers, really. They don't. They say, there's never been anybody. What are you talking about? You know. Nah, Jesus wants us to defeat our enemies and destroy those people who are trying to causing us loss, because God's grievously upset about all this loss that's taking place. You know, and that's not what Jesus says at all. God's not suffering any loss. No, reality's not suffering any loss. Reality's perfect, blessed, eternal delight. No need to protect anything from loss in existence. In a dream, dream has no effect. You don't go into a dream and desperately try and rearrange the dream, saying, oh my gosh, this dream, if it goes this way, reality is going to be destroyed, so I better prevent it from going this way. No. And my mom was unconcerned with the dream. She just sat there in bliss. I'm totally unconcerned with the dream. No worries. Didn't care. She said, whatever the dream wants to do, that's fine with me. That's her favorite saying. And whatever the dream wants to do, it's fine with me. It doesn't matter to me one way or the other. People would say, what are you talking about? You really don't care? She said, no, I don't really don't care at all. And so everybody was starving. She said, don't you care? She said, no. That's just a dream, you know, bringing all this. But doesn't matter to me one way or the other. Whatever the dream wants to do is fine with me. It doesn't matter, because it doesn't touch reality. Never will. And it's not our home, so we don't have to make a home here. You know, if this is our home, of course it would matter. She'd say, well, I got to, you know, get rid of this stuff, because this is your home. I got to make it nice for you. She said, no, it's not your home. This is not your home. This is just a wayside inn. This is just an imaginary dump. Don't have to fix anything here. Go back home. Go back home. Everything's fine. Return to your home. Everything's fine. So thanks to all these, you know, these great, great reassurers. We would not even be able to consider this stuff without these great reassurers. Really, it permeates. It's permeated the world. Even though we can reject these teachers or whatever, it's fine too. Reject them if you want to. But it's permeated the planet. It's permeated it. And there's this underlying conviction that the etheric parasites are trying to destroy. These reptilian psychic vampires are trying to destroy this conviction. They're working to undermine this conviction in the planet in every way they can possibly do. And they say, hey, you know, you don't need this conviction. Here's some pornography. You know, who needs this inner conviction? Throw it away. I got something better for you, you know. Oh, I've got this fabulous wardrobe. I got this fabulous fashion for you, you know. I got this makeover for you. Throw away this conviction, this stupid inner conviction you have. That's not worth anything. I got this fabulous makeover for you. I'm going to give you a whole makeover, you know. We'll make over your house. Make up over the whole house. Let's do a makeover. Throw away that inner conviction. Don't pay attention to it. Ah, I got some great entertainment. All these people will be blown up and torn to pieces, and we'll be shooting everybody. And wow, you know, throw away your stupid, you know, this some conviction you got that loss doesn't matter. Throw it away. Trade it in for this stuff, you know. Trade in that for these baubles, these glass beads, this tinsel, for this nothing, for this glamour. Ah, what do you need that conviction for? I can make you very glamorous. I'll show you how to be glamorous. I'll show you all the right way to glamorize yourself. Surround yourself with glamorous this and glamorous that and everything. You'll be so glamorous. You don't need that conviction. That's for superstitious people, you know. That's where people are superstitious in the backwoods, don't know what they're talking about. You don't want to be one of those folks, do you? You don't want to be one of those stupid, superstitious hicks in the backwoods, don't know what's drinking the moonshine, they're so crazy, don't know what they're doing. You want to be sophisticated. You want to be educated. You want to be an elite. Come on, get with the elite program. Get with the glamour. Here you go. Here's your makeover. Get yourself some new shoes, Mike. Get yourself 20 new shoes. Come on, get with it. Be chic. Be chic. Come on, go to the fashion show. Find out what chic is. Look at these glamorous people on the movie screen. They're chic. Get with it. Do what they do. Forget about this hick superstition about Jesus, you know, and forget about this, you know, who is this Ananda my mom, I don't even know who she is, you know. Forget about this conviction that loss doesn't matter, that you don't need to build a utopia here. That's crazy stuff, you know. Be stimulated. Go with our addictions so we can escalate them on you, you know. That's what the psychic vampires, the etheric parasites, vampires, reptilians, those, that's what they're doing. That's what they're telling you. That's what they're pushing. Put whatever you're vulnerable to, they're pushing it on you, you know. Men are very vulnerable to pornography, so they're pushing it on every man on the planet, you know. And women are vulnerable, more vulnerable to glamour, looking glamorous, you know. Glamorous, chic, you know, being chic. Being very stylish, being in vogue, you know. That's, we all have our weaknesses, okay? And whatever weakness we got, they exploit it to the max, to the max. And they say, hey, all you got to do is trade in that conviction, that inner conviction you got. Just throw that aside and pick up this chic, glamorous, or the pornography, or the drugs, the rock and roll, you know. Just pick that up and say that you'll like that a lot more, is what this is. The only thing is, now you think that reality is threatened by loss. And therefore, you are in a downward spiral. You're in a downward spiral. Because you got nothing but existence to hold on to now. And existence is nothing but loss. And then you try to protect yourself from loss by going along with the agendas of these psychic vampires, thinking that you can curry favor with them, that you can yourself have slaves at some point, that you can elevate yourself to get others to provide you with the safety and the energy that you want. And you end up being committing atrocities, you know, all this, you know, defending yourself, thinking you got to protect, and you end up becoming a tyrant. You end up doing things you never thought you would do. You end up becoming depraved, drug addict, suicide, ODing, on and on and on and on and on and on. The world is littered with the destruction and destitution of those who follow this path. It's getting worse and worse and worse. Whatever you do, don't trade away that conviction that you have. Don't trade away that conviction that you have, that reality is completely untouched and unconcerned with loss of any kind, ever. Don't trade that conviction away for anything. Not a million virgins in paradise. Don't trade away for that either. Okay. Don't trade away for that. Don't trade it away for a kingdom where everybody is working for you and manicuring your kingdom. Don't trade it away for that. For any reason, don't trade it away for any reason. That deep inner conviction that's permeated this planet, that you feel it, you say, you know, I feel something. I feel something. I don't go with this style of religion, I don't go with this spirituality, I don't go with this thing, I don't go with all the ritual, like for me, like Hinduism, all the rituals, you know, I don't know what that's about, I don't go for that, you know, I don't go for the trappings of religion and all these things, and I don't, you know, but I feel that there is a profound truth underlying all this stuff, you know. There's a profound truth there And so I'm going to hold on to that. And that profound truth is that reality is untouched by loss of any kind, has no effect on it whatsoever, is not threatened with it whatsoever, has no defenses against it whatsoever. That is the inner conviction. That is what you must hold on. That is the one thing that is the pearl of great price, that Jesus said, go sell everything you have and buy the pearl of great price. That is it. That is what these great witnesses come to assure us of in their own ways. They all have their own ways. Again, they put themselves in positions where their witnessing will be very powerful. And, you know, Jesus saw ahead of time that all of Judea would be wiped out, you know, and he told them there won't be a single stone standing on top of another. It's all going to be wiped out. He knew it. Right? But he didn't stay to defend against that, right? That's another profound witnessing. He didn't stay to, he knew he was going to lose his life, that his disciples would be martyred, and that Judea would be wiped out, and tribes of Israel scattered, you know, to the winds. He knew all of that. And yet he didn't stay to fight against any of it. He said, no, love your enemy. Agree with your adversary. Turn the other cheek. Forgive everyone. Love everyone. You know, don't buy into this loss-based scenario at all. You see? So that's permeated the planet. Permeated it. So we still have that pearl of great price. We still have some feeling of it. Those who have not been following the ways of depravity, that the despicable, you know, etheric parasites, vampires have been pushing upon us, demanding of us. They demand it, you know. They demand it of us. Those are saying, no. I'm not giving up that conviction for any reason. You know, stick with it. Stay with it. No matter what. No matter how tough it gets, there's a life raft in this terrible storm that's happening. And the early Christians, they stuck with it no matter what. They say, you want to crucify me? Go ahead, but I don't want you to. But, you know, I'm not giving up this conviction that I have, that I know is true for any reason, period. But, you know, certainly there's no reason for us to be crucified, because we already know that even the crucifixion of Jesus wasn't a loss for reality at all. So how could our crucifixion be a loss? Not possible. Because he had flawless love and peace and innocence and defenselessness, flawless, and even his crucifixion didn't cause any loss to reality in the slightest bit, so certainly ours won't either. Guaranteed. It's already guaranteed, so there's no point in even putting it to the test. So it's a waste of time. There's no reason for us to suffer. No reason for us to be crucified at all. None. We've already been shown that it's a closed case. The case is closed. And so when they say you're saved, if you believe in Jesus, you're saved, because, I mean, if you believe the case has been closed, then you don't need to be sacrificed. You can be passed over. If you accept that, you know, they say, you know, the death of Jesus saved us, meaning the case is now closed. He proved it. He proved it beyond a shadow of doubt that no loss, reality is affected, not affected by any loss of any type, even by the loss of the innocent. Perfectly innocent, the sinless, the innocent, those who know the truth that is affected, not affected by loss, even by the death of that body, that witness, it's not even affected by that. So guaranteed, it's not affected by our loss, and so we don't need to put it to the test anymore. You see, so that we're passed over. We can accept that. We'll be passed over. We don't need to die here. We do not need to die. For what? For what point? We don't need to prove any point. It's been already proven. And again, survivor's guilt, Ananda Mayama proved that. So, okay, those are two sides of proof. And Jesus also proved that by leaving here, and those would be killed after he left here, he showed that too. Okay? So he had a very profound showing there. And then Ananamaima also showed survival guilt, that all this stuff, all this loss, you know, for people in this way, while she was still here living, affected her not in the slightest bit. So even though we're in this world and we see all this bad stuff going down, we don't have to lose our conviction that this has no effect on reality. We can maintain our poise and peace. And it's, I think it's helped us during these times of, you know, savagery. I think it helped the world greatly. When she was here, it helped the world greatly. We may not have realized it, but these world wars and stuff, people would come to her and say, my gosh, you know, aren't you aware of this? She said, of course I am. I'm seeing, you know, these friends in Germany and in Europe, you know, falling down and getting back up, falling down. And she said, it's just a play, you know, it's a play between dear friends, and it's not affecting reality in the slightest bit. It's not affecting what they are. It's just this crazy pretend game they're playing. That's how she saw it. She goes, sure, I see it. And they asked, are you bothered by it? She says, no, not in the slightest bit. And so by radiating that assurance, you know, who's to say? And then she put that huge, three-year yantra, a fire of chanting Gayatri, what is it, mantra? I may not have said that right, because I'm not such a stickler for certain details, etc., to bring about the end of the world war. There's so many who wanted to do that she organized it and gave her blessings to it, but at the same time herself made it clear that she was not identified with this in any way, really. It wasn't her purpose to bring an end to anything. That whatever wants to come is fine with me, but you all want to do this, okay. I'm not going to stand in your way. She said, I'm not going to try to stand in your way if that's what you really want to do. And so who's to say? But basically that witnessing of, doesn't matter, whatever happens in this world, doesn't matter. And you can be in the world and be unaffected by it. You can be unaffected by it. That too permeated, it certainly permeated my generation. That conviction from Ramana Maharshi, Ananda Maima, and some others permeated my generation for sure. The 50s, the 40s, the 50s, the 60s, Ramana, you know, was permeating, and then Ananda Maima permeated India, she permeated it so much. And people went to India, they got that feeling, they came back and said, I got some kind of conviction, I don't know what it is. Everybody was going to India. The hippie trail, everybody's going there, and they say, there's something here. I don't know what it is. It's in the air. Is there some conviction here? You know, who do you think was building that conviction up? Ramana, Ananda Maima, and others were building that conviction up. And so people went to India, and they felt there's something here. There's something great. There's some conviction that nothing matters in this world. It doesn't matter. Loss doesn't matter. We're free. What we are is free of that, untouched by it. And they brought that conviction back to the Western world. And that spread, you know, and people started waking up and saying, wow, you know, and they started tuning into Jesus again in the right way, in my opinion. I was able to tune into A Course in Miracles because of the conviction I got from India. The people who went to India brought back the conviction of Ananda Maima and Ramana Maharshi. I got that. I was born with it, but I got it amplified in many different ways, many different angles. And then I came across A Course in Miracles. I said, my gosh, whoever wrote this is fabulous, has this tremendous conviction. And they say, you know, that it's Jesus Christ. And I have no reason to doubt it. And so I got that tremendous conviction from A Course in Miracles that indeed reality is completely untouched. And A Course in Miracles laid it out, the case out, in a reason-based way, rather than a crucifixion or something. Back at that time, a crucifixion was a powerful thing, and it spoke to people powerfully. Today, what speaks to us very powerfully is reason, clarification, intellect, etc. It was, A Course in Miracles lays out the case intellectually, so to speak. So I read that and I say, wow, very convincing, very compelling. Wow. And then you combine that with then Ananda Maima and Jesus, etc., with their witnessing, and you get this strong conviction. You start to understand it. You start to get it. So that transmission from India into the West, actually, for me, it enabled me to understand Jesus much, 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 much better, which is why I can talk about it this way very clearly. I really understand it very clearly. You know, so it's all good. It's all good. I didn't reject, you know, anyone who witnesses to truth. You know, I accept them. You know, it doesn't matter what their background is, what their religion is, what their tradition is. Doesn't matter, because truth is true. And if they're reassuring us that truth is always untouched by loss of any type, it has no concern whatsoever, no, zero, no defenses, doesn't need any, that is brings the conviction that we need. It brings the conviction that we need. Powerful, and we need that conviction. Super important right now, because those doggone, subtle, parasitic, vampire entities that are trying to convert everybody into their cattle to milk of their energy, and energy bodies, to prey on their energy bodies, to siphon everything off, to protect their little enclave and their elitism, etc. You know, they are termiting this planet. Termiting it. And you know the devastation that termites can do. And they are trying to convince everybody to trade in that conviction for junk, nothing, worthless, trash, you know, glamour, cheap thrills, cheap thrills, cheap thrills. That's all that they can offer us, is cheap thrills. That's it. That's it, cheap thrills. They got lots of cheap thrills to offer us. Cheap thrills of every kind. Sex and violence of every kind, right? Thrills of every, cheap thrills of every type, glamour of every type, drama of every type, brutality of every type, whatever cheap thrill you want, they have offering it to you now, thanks to these, you know, wonderful folks that have wired up the world and have made it possible now for us to have on-demand, cheap thrills on demand, 24-hour, 24/7. Aren't they great? Aren't they wonderful? Beware of Greeks bearing gifts, as it were. No disrespect to the Greeks, but that saying, you know, Trojan horse. Technology is a Trojan horse. Technology is a big time Trojan horse. It simply enables these vampires, psychic, these etheric vampires to flood us with these cheap thrills. Hey, you know, how can you possibly resist? I'm making it so easy for you, you know, just a click of the mouse and there it is. So that then we can be converted into this passive, hopeless cattle, this pathetic cattle to be milked forever and to produce our offspring so they can be milked, and cattle producing more cattle, sheep producing more sheep, as it were. Fleecing the flock entirely so they can fleece the whole flock of humanity. And they certainly are the ones that brought the technology into this world and set up all these companies and set up the capability to have 24/7 cheap thrills on demand for everybody on the planet. They certainly are the ones who did this. And their goal, again, is for us to trade in our convictions. You know, you see on all these different internet portals, etc., etc., it's unbelievable. They don't have any category for spiritual religion and spirituality. You know, YouTube doesn't have a, when I put the category, you know, I gotta put education, because it doesn't have any for religion and spirituality. Google's choices don't have any. All, you know, Facebook, you know, you name it, there might be some that have been a little bit, but it's incredible. You come across all this stuff and you choose a category, and there isn't any one for religion and spirituality. I just came across another one. I can't remember what it is, but it just blew my mind. There's like 30 choices, you know, to identify yourself, to sign up and identify what you're into, and no religion or spirituality, as if it doesn't exist. Ustream does have a category. Thank you, Ustream. Thank you very much. And thank people at Ustream because they're making it, this transmission possible. They do have a spirituality section, you know, even though it may be talking about, you know, psychics or something. They, at least they have it, you know, at least they acknowledge something there. But most of the high-tech companies don't even acknowledge it as a category or an interest. It's unbelievable. And that in itself should be absolute proof of what, where they're at. Absolute proof. They say, who needs that conviction that reality is untouched by loss when you can have 3 billion songs at your fingertip, you know, fingertips. All the movies that have been made at your fingertips. Who needs it? You must be crazy to hold on to just some vague, superstitious conviction when you can have all these songs at your fingertips. My gosh, all the entertainment right at your fingertips. Are you kidding me? You must be completely insane. Yeah, right. Yeah, right. Yeah, not one of those people would ever dare to be in the same, you know, in the same room with me, you know, or anyone that knows the truth, because they would just simply wilt and slink away like a skunk. I was in the presence of one of these big honchos once. They were going down a line shaking hands, and I was there, and when they got right before they got to me, someone interrupted them, and they turned away. They never made eye contact. They had not made any eye contact with me or recognized me. They turned away, and they talked to this person for a little while, and then they resumed the shaking hands, except they skipped over me, and they never even were aware that I was there at all. They shook everybody else's hand. This is one of the big wigs. You know. Couldn't handle it. They couldn't look me in the eye. No way. No way. They're terrified. They can't. They're cowards. They never can handle a true meeting, fellowship, a true meeting of fellowship with someone who is not willing to surrender their conviction. They cannot, because their whole agenda and purpose is for you to surrender that conviction. Their entire purpose, their whole identity is based on that. The identity they believe they can become is based on that. They're not aware that the identity of what that they already are is flawless and perfect. It can never be touched by loss. They believe it can be destroyed, and so they're looking to become a new identity. So they cannot handle somebody who refuses to drop that conviction. They cannot handle it. They cannot handle it. I don't dodge any. I'm not dodging those big dogs, you know. I'm not trying to avoid them or anything. But nah, they never show up around me except that one time, which is very interesting. Very, very interesting. I was even brought there. Somebody brought me, said, hey, you need to go here, go here, go here. And then I saw this guy. Here he is, you know, shaking every single one's hand, thanking everybody. And there again, passed me over entirely. Passed me over entirely. Amazing. Again, a brother in spirit, for sure. Everyone is. But it just shows you what their agenda is. All the agenda of all these high-tech companies for you to surrender your conviction. Period. That's all it is. 100%. And there may be a few companies that don't want to go all that far, you know? I'm not saying all technology companies are bad, but share the same agenda, and there are some who are trying to do some good work, and there's some ways to use this technology properly, which is what we're doing right now. There's some ways to do that. But the overwhelming cultural push and agenda and purpose, etc., is for you to surrender your conviction, your deep inner conviction. That is the purpose of it. That's the purpose of the pornographers as well. That's the purpose of the princesses. You know, let's turn all the women into princesses. You know, that's their purpose too, for you to surrender your conviction. This whole princess culture is unbelievable. Everybody wants to be a princess. All the, you know, seems like all the women want to be princesses. They want to be queens, you know. America is full of all these, you know, princesses, wannabe princesses. It's unbelievable. The whole world is, you know. You come across any woman that's rejecting it and wants to put her conviction in Christ, in reality, as being lossless, puts that first, whole different story. There's no princess there, you know. You can tell who has the princess complex and who doesn't. It's very obvious. Yeah, and of course, it's very tough for everybody here to because everybody's under pressure in some way to surrender their conviction, whatever there's their weak spot, whatever it is. And we all have weak spots. We all do. So, as a Christian, it's called the devil, which is these etheric vampires who, they know our weaknesses. They've studied us. They know how to attack our weaknesses. They know how to leverage it all. They know how to, you know, get us to surrender our convictions. They know how to do it. But you don't have to. You don't have to. You don't have to. You can stay strong. You can say, no, I'm not surrendering my conviction. You know, I'm resting my faith on the great examples, the great reassurers that we've had. Whatever. One, two, three, however many you want. You want just one, that's fine. If you want to say you rest your faith on Jesus, that's fine, because that's sufficient. If you want to say you rest your faith on Anandamayi Ma, that's fine, or Ramana Maharshi, that's fine, or some other guru, that's fine, or some other saint. I rest it on some saint, Saint Francis, or whoever. If you want to rest it on Buddha, or Muhammad, or whoever, that's fine. If you want to rest that conviction there, or if you want to rest it on several, that's fine. Or if you want to rest it on A Course in Miracles, that's fine. Or on, you know, Mary Baker Eddy's what, Science and Health with Key to Scriptures, or whatever, you know, rest it on that. Or if you want to rest it on any holy book, or whatever. If it brings that conviction that reality is lossless and is not threatened by any loss of dreams of any kind, not threatened by symbolic loss of any kind, that is the conviction you have to have. Rest on that. Don't trade it for these trinkets, these gadgets that are being sold. These gadgets are a trap. They want you to be 24/7 hooked in to this constant flow of cheap thrills and lossless that stimulates you again to produce the vibrations that they harvest, as it were, to keep themselves in protecting themselves from loss. Really, they're willing for you to be tortured and endlessly just to protect themselves from loss. You know, very, very amazing situation. Very delusional situation. So under no circumstances try to surrender your convictions. You really can't, because the truth is always there, but you can lose touch with the conviction and get caught up in this cheap thrillness. Because the cheap thrills are 24/7, powerful, you know, smartphones, you know, with you at all times. The pads now, tablets, pads, everybody's now hooked in, you know, they're all hooked in 24/7 to these cheap thrills that are saying, yes, reality is threatened by loss. That's what they're saying. Reality is threatened by loss. Reality can be destroyed. And you have to worry about that and defend against it and protect against it. That is what it's saying. And accept these cheap thrills. Accept these cheap thrills to turn you into a cow, to be milked for your energy. To enslave you. That is the purpose of it. The purpose of all these gadgets in high technology, etc., is enslavement. That's the purpose. That's what they want. And they want you to surrender your conviction that you can be saved. They want you to surrender it. They want you to reject it. They want you to reject it. Don't reject it. You don't have to. Stand tall. Stand assured. Stand assured. Stand with your faith in assurance that loss of any kind does not affect reality in the slightest bit. Not the slightest bit. I ask Anandamayi Ma, were you ever inconvenienced or bothered or irritated in your whole life? She says, not even the tiniest bit. Never. meaning reality is never bothered by any sort of dream. Any sort of denial is not even the slightest bit irritated by it. She said she would never in her whole life experience the slightest bit of irritation. Never. And those who were with her, you know, constantly, and it's always people around her, said that is true. So that is a true statement. It's not a joke. It's true. She could be decisive, you know, demanding, but as far as real irritation, none, zero. You see? So, this is frozen. Okay, it's back. So we do not need to surrender our conviction. It is true. Reality is untouched by any denial of reality. It's not bothered by it. It's not irritated by it. It's not threatened by it, nor irritated by it. It is in absolute delight and loves us perfectly. It's never wavered in the slightest bit. We can dream of our own destruction. It is not frightened by that. We cannot destroy ourselves. We cannot do anything to ourselves. We cannot harm what we are, because we are reality. We are one. Reality is one, and we are with that oneness. We are within that oneness of reality. Cannot be harmed in any way. There you go. All right. This is the first installment of Prime Time recording, and has gone extremely well. I was able to share an immense amount of sharing here of conviction. Hold on to your conviction. Don't trade it in for any trinkets, no matter what. Don't be intimidated by these honchos who tell you that you're crazy if you don't do it, and that it's hurting their ego, you know. Don't be intimidated by them. They can't even look you in the eye, you know? So, stay strong. Stay strong. Stay convinced. Stay reassured. And continue on that way. You must do that. You must do it. Okay? Very great. And we'll see what tomorrow brings. But this has been a great three-part Prime Time special. Prime Time special. This is the real Prime Time special that we delivered here to you, even under these very diffuse lighting conditions. All right, very great. That's it.